Good morning, and thank you for attending this virtual seminar. Because of COVID-19, this year has turned out to be very different from what any of us had imagined. The pandemic has affected every aspect of our lives, both professional and personal, as the virtual nature of this gathering reminds us one more time. And the same has been true for governments around the world. In the absence of an effective treatment or vaccine, authorities have been forced to take unprecedented lockdown measures to halt the spread of the pandemic. Today, we try to assess the impact of these containment measures, both on the spread of COVID-19 as well as on the economy. Now, we do this by combining daily data on the spread of COVID with novel high-frequency indicators of economic activity, such as the existence of nitrous oxide compounds in the atmosphere. By doing this, we can assess the impact of COVID-19 containment measures at a daily frequency, which helps us beat the fact that traditional measures of economic growth and economic indicators, such as GDP or industrial production, are available at a much lower frequency, monthly or quarterly, as well as with significant lags. Econometrically, it also helps us with identification. Now, Noor and I in today's talk will not go into the details of our estimate. It suffices to say that the measures have been extremely successful at limiting the spread of the virus, but they have come at an enormous economic cost in terms of short-term output losses. What we will focus on instead today is on the experience of Asian economies. Asian economies were some of the first to be hit, and they had to put in place strict lockdown measures to halt the spread of the virus. Quick and decisive action by some of these economies has now enabled them to begin to reopen their economies. What lessons can the rest of the world learn from the experience of these countries? The first lesson seems to be the importance of acting decisively and quickly. We captured the speed at which countries responded to a COVID-19 outbreak by using a metric which is commonly used in the epidemiological literature, public health response time. Put simply, public health response time captures the number of days it took authorities to put in place or tighten containment measures once a significant outbreak was reported. As we see on the left-hand chart in this slide, Asian countries did reasonably well on this metric, most likely due to their past experience with earlier pandemics. And this helped them flatten the pandemic curve. As we see on the right-hand side, countries such as Vietnam or the Pacific Island states that acted quickly and decisively were able to reduce the number of infections from COVID significantly as compared to an average country, and particularly when you compare them to countries that were relatively slow in acting. Our second lesson pertains to the conditions that were put in place at the time of easing of the lockdown. Our analysis suggests that in countries such as Korea, where strong testing and tracing policies were put in place when containment was eased, and they were ready with localized lockdowns where needed, easing of containment measures did not lead to a significant increase in the number of COVID cases after the containment measures were eased. We look at this metric 30 days after containment was eased. This is in contrast to other countries where testing and tracing policies were not strong, and there we see a significant spike in the number of COVID-19 infections after easing of lockdowns. Our third lesson is related to the timing of the exit. We find that countries that eased lockdown when the number of new cases were relatively low witnessed an increase in mobility after easing of the restrictions. Mobility for us proxies for individual behavior stemming from the fear of being infected. The increase in mobility in turn led to an increase in economic activity in these countries. This is in sharp contrast to other countries where containment measures were relaxed when the number of COVID-19 cases were still high or increasing. In these countries, mobility did not pick up, and neither did economic activity. This points to the fact that people were scared and lacked confidence, and there were worries about a second wave. I now hand it over to Noor to talk about the macroeconomic policies that can help in these circumstances. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Pragyan. So we found evidence that containment measures were very effective in halting the spread of the COVID-19 pandemic. However, and I'm sure you would all agree with me, these measures led to huge changes in our lives, which in turn affected economic activity. If you think about it, do you remember the last time that you went to the movies or to a restaurant? Or do you remember the last time that a hairdresser actually cut your hair? These are just few examples of how containment measures, though they were crucial for saving lives, ended up being very costly because of the nature of the lockdown, which mandates social distancing. In fact, the impact of containment measures was unprecedented in short-term economic costs and was adverse across all sectors, but specifically those that require human interaction, such as tourism or services. So, what can countries do? Well, countries can mitigate some of the costs of containment measures by using supportive policies. And this brings us to lesson four. Use macroeconomic policies to cushion the blow. If you look on the left hand, the chart shows the decline in industrial production through the losses in nitrogen dioxide emissions 30 days after the implementation of containment measures. The results suggest that in countries where large fiscal stimulus measures were used, economic losses were partly offset. But in contrast, losses in economic output were much larger in countries that provided limited fiscal support. And the same seems to hold for monetary policy. In countries where central banks significantly lowered the policy rate, losses in economic output were also partly offset. However, these losses were much larger in countries where smaller policy rate cuts were implemented. But let's take a closer look to the role of fiscal policy during the COVID-19 crisis. We study the impact of announced fiscal measures in almost 40 countries since the beginning of the pandemic. And we find these fiscal measure announcements have positive effects on economic activity, as shown on the right-hand side. However, this impact can vary according to a country's characteristics. For example, it is stronger in more closed economies, as any additional demand from the fiscal expansion is less likely to be leaked out through higher imports. Also, the impact of announced fiscal measures is stronger in countries with lower debt levels. And this is because economic agents in that country are less likely to become concerned in the near term with the rise in debt levels. But also, fiscal measures were particularly helpful during those months of low economic activity, which we measure by mobility or NO2 emissions, as probably these measures provided much needed support during the downturn. And finally, we find that during those months of low economic activity, announced fiscal measures had significant impact at the time that containment measures were being eased, or in other words, when restrictions on the economy from the lockdown were being lifted, as this provided more opportunity for fiscal stimulus to circulate in the economy. And so to sum up, life has become drastically different for almost all of us since the beginning of the pandemic. And though containment measures are being eased in many countries, it is likely that it will take longer for our lives to go back to normal. and the same holds for economic activity. When we observed the decline in NO2 emissions during the lockdown period, we estimated that industrial production could have been reduced by almost 12% 30 days after the implementation of containment measures. However, the rebound in economic activity 30 days after the relaxation of containment measures is only about 6%, or about half of the losses that we registered during the lockdown period. And so, in other words, this means that scarring is already evident by the weak economic recovery. And this can be explained by many factors, such as the changes in an individual's behavior related to the fears of getting infected, or the containment measures that remain in place to avoid a second wave of infections and also to maintain social distancing. And so, going forward, it is crucial to limit further scarring and to lay the foundation for economic recovery. The lessons learned from Asia could be quite useful here, and especially to minimize the risk from a second wave of infections. And they are to act quickly to flatten the pandemic curve, to put in place strong testing and tracing policies that avoid a second wave of infections, to roll back containment measures only after an outbreak has been stabilized, and last but not least, to continue to support economic activity through the use of comprehensive macroeconomic policies as they reduced the cost of containment and they sustained the economic recovery going forward. Thank you so much for tuning in. Please stay safe, and we hope to see you next time in real life.